Looking for a new or used vehicle? The Auto Channel has dozens of searchable databases with the latest pricing information, in-depth specifications, and tons of reviews, and it's all available free.
My welcome to Steve's. Thank you for joining us this morning. It's an exciting day for General Motors. Today marks the beginning of a new company, our company, one that will allow every single employee, including me, to return to the business of designing, building, and selling great cars and trucks and serving our customers. And there's nothing that we want to do more than that. A lot of people thought we couldn't move through the 363 sale process as fast as we did. I want to thank everyone involved for a truly amazing effort to make it happen. From the GM team, our team of excellent advisors, and most importantly, to the U.S. and the Canadian government, the Automotive Task Force, and the taxpayers of the U.S. and Canada, who have been the key part of making this happen. We deeply appreciate the support we've received during this historic transformation, and we'll work hard to repay the trust and the money that so many have invested in GM. The last 100 days has shown everyone, including ourselves, that a company not known for quick action can in fact and indeed move very fast. Starting today, we want to take that intensity, the decisiveness, and the speed of these last several weeks, and then transfer it from the battlefield triage of the bankruptcy process to the day-to-day operation of the new company. And this will be the new norm at General Motors. All of you have copies of our press release, so I won't go into any detail about the makeup of the new General Motors. Instead, I'd like to talk for a few minutes about my three priorities for the new GM, three very simple ones: customers, cars, and culture. And let me take them in that order. First, customers. And I place them first because they need to simply be our top priority, our only priority in many ways. At the new GM, we need to make the customer the center of everything. And we're going to be obsessed with this because if we don't get this right, nothing else is going to work. It's that simple. With a quality gap substantially eliminated, one of the new frontiers in the automotive industry, we think, is going to be customer service, true customer service, which makes it that much more important that we make the customer the center of our universe. We're committed to listening to our customers, responding to consumer and market trends, empowering the people of General Motors who are closest to the customer to make decisions, and seek opportunities every day for direct communication between our customers and employees at every level, starting with me. Next week, we're launching a Tell Fritz website for consumers, or anybody actually, to share their ideas, concerns, and suggestions directly with the senior management. I'll review and respond to input every day. Of course, other executives and I will continue to reach out to customers through our ongoing electronic communications. Starting in August, thank goodness, I'll go on the road every month to meet with consumers, dealers, suppliers, employees, and others in the U.S. and abroad who directly impact our relationship with customers and key partners. And I'll be asking other members of my management team to do the same. This is something that I've done throughout my career, and I can assure you I welcome this opportunity again. Together and individually, we need to listen to the questions, ideas, and concerns of the people who matter most. Those are the people who own and drive General Motors cars and trucks, and use that information to build better cars and trucks and provide better levels of service going forward. I am personally committed to being closer and more available to consumers than ever before. More importantly, we're determined as a leadership team to make GM owners the most excited and loyal consumer base in the industry. Our focus on consumers will also extend beyond GM, through GM, and through our great dealer network. With a significantly leaner and healthier network, both we and our dealers will be able to focus more resources on providing customers with the best level of service. Our dealers have committed to making the changes necessary to improve the total customer experience for GM vehicle owners. We're working on new ways, for example, to make car buying even more convenient for consumers, including an innovative new partnership with eBay, for example, in California, an experiment, if you will, which is intended to experiment with potentially revolutionizing how people might actually buy vehicles online. Consumers will be able to actually bid on vehicles just like they do in an eBay auction, including the option of choosing a predetermined buy it now price. Think of it as a physical auction for dealers reinvented for the online consumer. We'll be testing this and other ideas with our dealers over the next few weeks and hope to expand and build upon them in the coming months. In all cases, our goal is to make the shopping and buying process as easy as possible for GM customers on their time in on their terms. Stay tuned. Second major focus for GM that we have as a leadership team is really simply about cars. So I've said many times in the last 100 days, and I frankly said throughout my career, there's never been a successful turnaround in the global automotive industry without a focus on both the cost and revenue sides of the business. You have to do it on both sides. To win, we need to stabilize and, in fact, grow our business around the globe, and particularly here in the United States. And that means building more of the gorgeous, high-quality, fuel-efficient cars, trucks, and crossovers that consumers want, and getting them to the market faster than ever before. Toward that end, we plan to launch 10 vehicles in the U.S. and an additional 17 outside the U.S., actually over the next 18 months. We are going to drop the word competitive from our vocabulary in the area of product development. Going forward, our aspiration, our objective, and the objective of Tom Stevens, the entire product development organization, is to create products that consumers can judge as best in class, and anything less is just simply not acceptable as an aspiration. We may not always reach this level, but if we don't set that level for ourselves, we won't accomplish our goals. And the goal is to have our vision is clear, to design, build, and sell the best vehicles in the world, something that General Motors was known for many years ago, then something that we need to reestablish. One way we'll achieve this goal is by focusing on, for example, in the U.S., four core brands, Chevrolet, Cadillac, Buick, and GMC. And populating these four brands with just 34 nameplates next year, down from 48. It's about getting every nameplate right. This emphasis on fewer, better entries will enable us to devote more engineering and marketing resources to each model, like the products we're launching in the U.S. this year. Vehicles like the smoking hot Chevrolet Camaro and the Equinox, Chevrolet Equinox, the Buick LaCrosse, the GMC Terrain, Cadillac SRX, and our CTS Sport Wagon. And you'll see in the products we're launching around the world the same sort of passion. Cars like the Chevrolet Viva in Latin America, the Chevrolet Cruze and Buick Excella in Asia Pacific, and the Opel Astra coming this fall in Europe. I should add that a key part of our product focus is a continued emphasis on environmental technology. We're road testing pre-production Chevrolet Volt extended range electric vehicles now, and we plan to bring the car to the market before the end of next year. We announced a new small car last month to be built right here in Michigan. It will add to our growing portfolio of U.S.-built, highly fuel-efficient vehicles and restore about 1,400 direct jobs in this country and many more indirect jobs in this country and in our home state of Michigan. This was a business decision. It's about producing fantastic, beautiful small cars and earning a return on it with highly competitive manufacturing facilities and labor agreements. We're making advanced battery development a core competency for the new GM. You can expect additional news later this summer. We've already made a number of important announcements, and we will continue to bang the drum to make sure that we get our job done in terms of advanced battery development. In short, the products and technologies we're launching this year and next are clear demonstrations of our long-term commitment to exciting design, great fuel efficiency, and world-class quality. These are the cars, trucks, and crossovers that will put us back on the consumer shopping list and the road to profitability and success. Finally, we're working to change, we must change, the culture at GM with a focus around customers and products, speed, accountability, and risk-taking. There's a lot of work to do here, and we need to start at the top. We have a new board of directors, General Motors, led by our new chairman, Ed Whitaker, who's with us here today. And I've asked Ed to come up and make a few remarks. Ed, please. Welcome, Ed.
Thank you, Fritz. Well, good morning. And it's a pleasure to be here. This is a great day for General Motors. Thank you, Fritz, for introducing me. I'd like to also express my appreciation to everyone who's played a role in launching this exciting new company, and it is an exciting new company. I think you could appreciate how challenging it is to turn around a complex business like this. There have been a lot of long hours, there have been a shuttering of plants, there have been some painful layoffs, and I salute everyone who has worked to bring General Motors this far, this fast. I agreed to be chairman of General Motors because, like so many people, I've always admired this company. You know, for 100 years, General Motors was among the world's greatest companies. It deserves to be there again, and it will be there again. Perhaps more than anything else, I agreed to take this job because I know most Americans want this company to succeed. And I think that speaks volumes, many volumes, about the potential of this company, the potential we have, and the great opportunity we have to make it happen. Don't misunderstand now, there's still a lot of work to be done to get GM where we need it and where we want it to be. But we certainly have the fundamentals at this company. The number one fundamental is its people. We have great people at this company, and they're going to make great things happen. Along with that, we have the technology, we certainly have the products, and we have the drive to succeed. So we're all excited about that. The employees I've met as I've been around the company, which is a short time, and the board members that I have met and know are up to this challenge, and they're going to be a great part of this turnaround story. I'm a big believer in strong leadership. We have that in Fritz and in this top management team. I know they're poised to make great strides in the near future, and you're going to see a lot of action around General Motors. I like to tell you this, we all want to win, and we are going to win. It's exciting. We're going to put forth our very best efforts. We appreciate the efforts of everyone else who's helped us get to this point today, and I look forward to being the chairman of General Motors, and thank you for listening to me and for attending. And Fritz, I'll turn it back to you.
Thanks, Ed. Appreciate it. Thank you. Really appreciate Ed's attendance here with us. Let me also add my thanks to board member Kent Kressa, who up till today actually was operating as interim chairman of General Motors, especially for his work in continuing to build the new board of directors. And I'd also like to thank the prior board members who've left the GM board. And I look forward to working with Ed, the new board, with a renewed and continued dedication to world-class standards of corporate governance. Beyond the new board, we're also changing the structure of the company today. We announced, first thing we're going to do is announce that the two senior leadership forum, decision-making forums that we use today, the Automotive Strategy Board, which is made up of our regional presidents as well as our global functional leaders, and our Automotive Product Board, which is made up of, in essence, the ASB and product development leadership, is going to change. Going forward, these two groups will be replaced by a single, smaller executive committee that will meet frequently, weekly, to anticipate and respond to customer and market needs. This team will focus on business results and products, brands, and customers, and much of our work will be done outside of our headquarters here in the Renaissance Center, at design, at our proving ground in Milford, at operations around the globe, and the places where we can connect to the people developing our cars, trucks, technology, people who develop them, and the people who sell them. This move alone will cut the top-level decision-making team, the size of it, in half. We're also removing layers of management, reducing the number I previously announced, reducing the number of U.S. executives by 35%, overall U.S. salaried employment by 20% by the end of the year. Very difficult moves, significant sacrifices made by all, including our salaried workforce here in the U.S. This is all about, however, flattening the organization and driving broader spans of control. We're eliminating the matrix structure we've employed, simplifying the organization to establish clear accountability for performance. The bottom line is business as we've known it, and as we've had it up to today, business as usual is over at General Motors. It's a new era. We have to have the highest expectations for ourselves, and everyone associated with the company must realize this and be prepared to change, and fast. A significant change that comes from this involves our regional structure. Going forward, as I am the president and chief executive officer of GM, working closely with Ed, but as part of that, in addition to my global responsibilities, and as part of my global responsibilities, I take responsibility for our operations here in North America. This means we're eliminating our North America president position and the North American strategy board, in effect, an entire level of management. Global functional leaders will also have responsibility for running their parts of the business here in North America. In addition to replacing the existing regional structures, we'll be coordinating our global operations under one group. To that end, I'm pleased to announce that Nick Riley will take responsibility for GM International Operations, reporting to me, part of the Executive Committee, and Nick and our international operations will remain headquartered in Shanghai, China. The existing regional strategy boards are being eliminated, removing a layer of management. The regional strategy boards help strengthen GM's presence in key markets, but given the changes in the industry and in our company, we're taking a more streamlined approach to running the business. It also reflects a realization that we need to run the business going forward through more collaboration and in shared power structures, including in Europe. The European business is operated as an integrated business, but it is our expectation that going forward we'll be in a minority position within our European business, and we'll work with our European business as a key partner, but we will not have direct management responsibility for the business going forward. Details of this new structure, including key leadership changes, will be communicated later this month. All of this is aimed at reducing bureaucracy and driving more accountability and a much stronger customer focus. To help us put an even greater focus on the customer going forward, we've asked a vice chairman to be responsible for all creative elements of our products and our customer relationships. I'm happy to announce that today we're unretiring Bob Lutz. And we've asked Bob to fulfill this critical new position. As you know, actually probably, I mean, it's not, it's as everybody knows, Bob announced that he had planned to retire. He had not made the announcement earlier this year, and he changed his mind. And actually, we're very grateful for that. Bob has a passion for this responsibility. And from my perspective, this is the best way I knew of to prevent Bob from recycling through another set of OEMs. Bob and Tom Stevens will work together as a team, partnering with Ed Welburn to guide the creative elements of design, but design remains part of product development. Bob's responsibilities beyond creative design, however, will include brands, marketing, advertising, and communications. They will report to him, and it's his job to integrate those activities and provide accountability for consistent messaging and results. Bob has a proven track record of change and unleashing creativity in the design and the development of GM cars and trucks, and this new role will allow him to take a further step in the parts of GM that connect directly with consumers. Bob will report directly to me, be part of and an active member of the newly formed executive committee that I spoke of a moment ago. The announcements today reflect an approach to speed and decision-making that we want to be a key characteristic of the new GM. We had planned for a bankruptcy process of between no more than 60 to 90 days. We took the earliest part of that period, which is approximately July 31st, and we wanted to have the organization and the cultural-related elements of change ready to go by July 31st. Well, the judge decided, the stay ended. We had the opportunity to close in 40 days, and we did. So now we'll move in the next 2 to 3 weeks to finalize the organization moves. It was important for us to move, to close, and we'll make adjustments quickly and have the people in place by the end of this month. We have great cars and trucks and crossovers today. We have a product line brimming with new and exciting entries. We have the important parts of the business necessary to make General Motors great again. Our dealer network is outstanding and will be even better on a right-sized basis with great business opportunities going forward. Compared to the old GM, we have a significantly stronger balance sheet, a much stronger cash position, and a very competitive cost structure. In fact, for example, in terms of debt, our U.S. debt is approximately $11 billion in addition to about $9 billion of preferred stock. That's just on the capital structure side of the business. On the cost structure side of the business, we feel we're very, very competitive. Going forward, we pledge to be transparent in our financial and other reporting. I think Ray Young described it best. We'll be the world's most public-private company. And we expect to have that transparency every day. We expect that the company would be taken public as soon as practical, expected next year. And while we're required to pay off our government loans by 2015, our goal is to repay those loans much sooner. At GM, we take these loans very personally, and we take paying them off as a key financial goal. They represent an enormous obligation to our fellow taxpayers, and we will move quickly to pay them off. In short, GM has what it takes to excel, but with no interest whatsoever today in making excuses nor in debating the past. We need to be accountable for this. From this point on, our efforts are dedicated to customers, cars, culture, and paying back the taxpayers, both the loans and in creating real value for shareholders and the shareholders in many ways, whether it was the taxpayers who were providing capital or the bondholders and the other creditors of the old GM who have a stake in the company or the UAW Viva. It's about creating value so that the sacrifices that are being made, which are immense, are worth it. And people get the maximum recoveries and General Motors can be great again. We know we have to back these promises, and our commitment is that we will. Thank you very much for your time this morning. Let's now open it up for questions.
Okay, we're going to start with Phil LeBeau. Those of you on the phones, again, if you want to ask a question, please push star one, and we'll cue you in. We'll take some questions in here first, and we will start with Phil.
Fritz, there's an expression, you can't teach an old dog new tricks. So why should the public believe that the new GM will be different, be more responsive, be more nimble than the old GM?
Well, I talked about a number of changes today. And the interesting thing, Phil, if you look at where you spend your time as a leadership team, and I think about the last 2 years, the problems that we've been working to solve, we're not all done, but we have a huge amount of them behind us. This basically frees us up to spend our time where we need to spend our time: products, customers, brands, winning in the marketplace. That's where we're going to spend our time, Phil. And in the end, we simply have to prove ourselves. We have to see what we do, and then have to see what results we have. And that's how we'll prove ourselves. Your point is you can't teach an old dog new tricks is true. I also pointed out to my management team Einstein's definition of insanity, doing the same thing over and over again, expecting a different result. We know we have to change. Today is about the beginning of that change, and it's our job to prove to you and to everybody that we can get that job done.
We're going to move to Mary Conway.
Mary Conway, WXYZ. Hi, Fritz.
Hi, Mary.
Might you elaborate a little more about what's going to go into Orion Township, the small car? Can you tell us what that vehicle exactly will be and how soon we'll see people working?
I might, but I won't, actually, because I would like to actually save a few surprises. It won't be just one vehicle, though. There'll be a family of vehicles that will be put into the Orion plant, and there will be an appropriate time to do that, but it's not today.
We'll take a question from Paul Eisenstein. A question, Paul.
Oh, that's impossible, actually.
When you look forward, what is the new GM? I mean, you're going to be a smaller company. You're going to have more limited operations, more limited divisions and all. With Mr. Whitaker coming on board in particular, where do you see yourself going, not just in the next 6 months or a year or 2 years? What is GM's goal to be when you put all this that you keep promising in place?
Well, the goal is to reestablish GM as a company known for winning in the marketplace with great vehicles, great designs, and great technology. Winning with customers, and we do that with what we've done on the cost side of the business, what we've done on the capital structure side of the business, we can create real value. The work, we still have some work to do on cost and capital structure, but I actually feel we have a huge amount of that behind us. And so now it's 100% of the time on the revenue side, which is products, customers, putting them first, and spending all of our time as a leadership team in that area. And if we do that, sometimes you like to sit down and write your closing of the book before you start the book. I'm not so presumptuous to do that, but I think we can do something really special with this business. And it's not about size. It's not about bigness. It's about, real value and doing something special. And then if we do that, we can create some real value.
Take one from Rod Maloney. Yeah,
hi, Fritz. Rod Maloney, WDIV-TV Detroit. Two-part question, single question. Green logo, number one, and then sort of stepping off of that, this notion of the federal government and its input in the company and its ability to basically tell you what to do.
First, on the green logo, when I saw the email yesterday on Bloomberg, usually I always believe everything I read on Bloomberg, but I said, what on earth is this, actually? I have no idea what that was about, actually. All right. So I have no idea what it's about, and it's not in my plans, actually. Now, the second part on the government, we've had, through this process, the government as the purchaser. So we've had very active involvement every day at multiple levels, as you would with any purchaser of the business. What Steve Ratner and the Automotive Task Force and the Canadian government, not just simply the U.S. government, have really asked Ed Whitaker to do is form a world-class board, and that world-class board oversee the company and exercise, true world-class corporate governance, holding the management team accountable for results. I have every expectation that they will do exactly that. Not interested, I've heard Steve Ratner say many times, he has no ability to pick the colors of cars. and he doesn't want to, actually. He wants the company to perform, as any shareholder should, and he wants to use Ed Whitaker and the board of directors to hold us accountable for that. I am very confident that's exactly what will happen.
Fritz, we're going to move this side of the room. Sharon Turlep.
Hey, Sharon.
Hi. Fritz, you have a lot of very troubled suppliers, either in bankruptcy or headed there. What are you going to do to ensure that their problems don't derail everything that you've done here?
Well, as an industry, we have some troubled suppliers. I would say my observation on how the supplier base has managed the situation so far has been we've been pleasantly surprised by the situation. It's a tough situation for suppliers, just given a 10 million unit industry. Inventory corrections on the part of certainly GM and Chrysler, and so very low levels of volume. Lear filing last week, talked to the CEO of Lear. I think they have a good plan to get themselves reorganized, and I think many suppliers have adapted, I think quite well to a difficult environment with very aggressive plans to exit bankruptcy themselves and continue to be world-class suppliers. Our biggest challenge from a supply base continues to be supporting Delphi in their emergence from bankruptcy. This is an important month, key dates, including today, for example, a court hearing. There's a process involved through this month about auctioning the business. We're supporting that because in terms of supply priorities, that's my number one priority to get Delphi in good hands. And then other suppliers, we've been... It's interesting. Day one motions in the court, we got the court to approve our troubled supplier program. We've worked with our suppliers. We've done it, I think, the right way. The Treasury's factoring program has been helpful in this regard. And let's face it, we as an industry need to get through a 10 million unit industry. And I think what you've seen is a huge amount of supplier consolidation share, and I think we'll see more of that. And I think we and our suppliers will get through this.
I'm going to go to the far right, Jamie LaRue from Automotive News.
Hi, Jamie.
Hi, Fritz. How are you?
Good.
Question about the changes in marketing. First of all, what's going to happen with Mark LaNave as Bob steps into the role of brands and marketing? And then secondly, if you could describe how you would like to see GM's marketing proceed going forward that could help change and bring the company forward in terms of marketing.
First of all, we'll separate marketing from sales. Bob won't be responsible for sales. And so what we'll do is we will basically merge the marketing, image, brand, advertising, the creative elements of the marketing mix under Bob. Sales will report directly to me. And frankly, it's not like I'm going to divorce myself from marketing either. Basically, I work with Bob. But I think the issue is we have a lot of work to go to basically get our marketing emphasis as carefully coordinated as possible. I do think that Bob, knowing Bob, will be a change agent. I do think it's our job to look at it from top to bottom to make sure that we are getting our marketing and our public messages aligned with what we want to do with our products. The beauty of it is we now get to focus behind four core brands. It's not like we have to do it anymore across eight brands. We can do it across four, and we're excited about it. So I do think there will be some obviously changes in Mark's job for sure because we're basically bifurcating the two responsibilities, sales and marketing. But the sales activity is not to be underestimated in its importance, actually. It's extremely important. Well, we actually have a huge amount of change going on. Mark is head of sales today, because we're not, frankly, going to be going with, we have a lot of changes we need to make between here and the end of July, and Mark is responsible for hitting his sales numbers this month. I said before that we have basically the North America structures going away. We have a lot of regional structures going away. We got a lot of people moves that need to be dealt with in the short term.
Take Joanne Muller, and then we'll take some questions on the phone.
Hi, Fritz.
Hi, Joanne.
I'm wondering, in Washington, Congress is considering a lot of heavy lobbying from the dealer groups, and I'm wondering what will happen if Congress takes action to reverse some of the dealer closings that you've done. What would be the impact on GM? How would you handle it?
Well, we'd comply with law, as we always do. I think we worked hard to handle our wind downs. Our dealers who were wound down in as responsible fashion as possible. Obviously, if you just look at the percentage of dealers, both continuation dealers and wind down dealers who accepted our agreements, they were well over 99% in both cases, which I think shows that the vast majority of our dealers even in the tough situation, appreciated how GM handled it. We certainly don't think it's warranted, and because I think we've tried to handle this in a responsible way as possible, but if changes happen, we just adapt. I mean, that's what we do. But I think we did handle the situation to the best of our abilities in as responsible way as possible to try to not only soften the blow for dealers, but also manage an orderly wind down, if you will, of the dealer body. And I think we did it responsibly. We'll just have to see.
We're going to go to the phone now. David Shepherdson from the Detroit News. Go ahead, David.
Thanks, Fritz. Two quick questions. Can you tell us what Troy Clark's status is going to be after this and how many total management jobs your announcement is eliminating today? And do you think the taxpayers will be made whole at the end of this process? You have about $11 billion in government loans, but will taxpayers ultimately get the $50 billion back, do you think?
Well, as I said, we've eliminated the President of North America job. I have a number of moves that we need to make in the next 2 to 3 weeks, including with Troy. So I would say stay tuned, but the job really no longer exists. This is really about, in terms of how many, I haven't counted up today, how many jobs are affected, but it's really part of leaning out about 35% of our executive workforce here in the U.S., particularly at the senior level. So this is an enabler. This is not on top of. This is an enabler to getting that done. With respect to your second question, return to the taxpayers, our performance will dictate that. The first goal, obviously, the first financial goal will be to repay the loans. But as part of that, it's about creating value for shareholders. And our performance will over time drive whether or not the taxpayer is completely, quote, made whole, end quote.
We'll go on to Ted Reed at thestreet.com. Ted, you on the line?
Yes, thank you. A couple of quick things. You said, Fritz, you said the U.S. debt is $11 billion plus $9 billion in preferred stock. What was it before that? And secondly, I'd like to know the relation now between the new GM and Liquidation Motors. Is there any continued relationship? And is there any benefit that can accrue to the new GM from the liquidation of Liquidation Motors?
Motors Liquidation is the name of the old General Motors. There will be transition services agreements that General Motors, there's some General Motors people will provide, but the new General Motors will not derive any benefit from the liquidation of the old General Motors. The amount of funds that were provided for the wind down is $1.175 billion, which is funding that was provided to facilitate the orderly wind down that's expected to be the cost of winding down the old General Motors. And then the return, if you will, for the unsecured bondholders and other creditors would be equal to then 10% of the new General Motors plus the warrants that they would receive. But the new General Motors will not derive any benefit from the old General Motors, but there will be transition services. Debt. I promised myself not to make this a financial presentation, but I think if you look at the amount of debt that we had beforehand, you had $27 billion of unsecured bonds. You had tens of billions of dollars of obligations for post-retirement health care. You had $5 billion, actually $6 billion of secured debt. And then you had all of the Treasury debt, including both pre-petition financing and post-petition financing. So we're talking about, very big numbers when you add it all up. And I promised myself I wouldn't put the table together, but would be happy to come back to you and provide you an answer on that separately.
We'll take one more on the phone. I think it's Robert Schoenberger from the Cleveland Plain Dealer.
Hi, good morning. You mentioned this auction process in California. Can you go into some more detail on that and whether or not that would be rolled out nationwide?
Well, experiments are experiments, actually. You don't roll them out until you figure out if they work. We're excited about it, but I wouldn't commit to rolling it out more broadly until we find out if it's successful.
Okay, next question in the room, Jeff Flock.
Hi, Fritz. Jeff Flock from the Fox Business Network. Just to clarify on Rod's question about the green, do I understand you to say there's nothing going on at GM looking at the potential of changing the logo in any way?
It's interesting. This is a pretty big place, actually, and so people have a lot of creative ideas. I can tell you, though, it's not on my desk to change, and I don't have any plans to do it.
Gotcha. It sort of dovetails into the question about government, and a follow-up on the government question as well. I heard what you said, and that the government would like the board to be its representation there. But can I ask you what kind of going-forward contact you personally expect to have with members of the task force? What do you understand their role to be as you go forward? Do you have daily consult with them? Do you suspect that's what will happen going forward? And what can you say to a public, a part of a public that is concerned that the government is too involved?
Well, the second question I try to get at with Rod. I mean, I do think that it's not only what they said, it's what they've done. I mean, we had a chance over even the last several days to sit down and kind of do a final debrief with key members of the task force who were here with myself and with Ed to make sure we got their final observations going into the, quote, closing. They really want Ed and the board to take responsibility for overseeing the company. I do think, you know, as I said, our discussions have been daily at multiple levels as we've tried to go through the transaction. I think going forward, it won't be daily anymore. I think there will be, as you would naturally have, if you got one shareholder with 60.8%, there will be regular reporting, for example, of our results. By the way, our results will be putting out 8-Ks. We'll be doing all kinds of things in terms of talking about our results. Even though we'll be a private company, I think we will be providing information regularly to the government as well as externally. But I certainly think the nature and the frequency of the dialogue will change fundamentally, effective today.
Let's move over here. Bill Vlasic, New York Times.
Hi, Fritz.
Hi, Bill.
Can you give us more clarity on how you will be paid and receive the government money through the remainder of this year? Mr. Ratner said the other day there's about $19 to $20 billion that is going to come to GM before the end of 2009. What's the schedule for that? How do you get that money? And what's the relationship with the government during that process? Yeah.
All the money's been received at this point. What we'll do, this will be a subject for a different day, actually. We'll come back and provide you a much more specific answer to that question. I just, today was not the day to do it. But think of this as all the money's now been received. I anticipate that a reasonably large portion of that money will be held in escrow and may or may not be dispersed depending upon what happens over the next year. And we'll have a chance to actually tell you how much that is, what are those terms. Certainly before the end of this month, we'll be able to lay it out for you.
David Welch from Business Week.
Hey, Fritz.
Hi, David.
These different positions, the regional group vice presidents, that are those jobs that are going away, are these executives simply leaving the company? Are they gone, or will they be soon? And the other question is these brands, some of the brands that are up for sale, Hummer, Saturn, Saab, who gets the money from that? Does that go to old GM, or do the proceeds, whatever there is, go to new GM?
The changes that are being made, as I talked about, the regional structures, some of the people in the regional structures are going away, will retire or will leave the company. Some will actually be, you know, obviously redeployed into other jobs. So, I mean, that's work in the next 2 to 3 weeks. I would have had this done had we closed July 31st, but we closed July 10th. So we'll have a chance to actually review individual names and how those jobs are affected before the end of this month. Your second question, David?
Proceeds from the sale.
Oh. Generally, the proceeds from the sale are at the new company, of the brands. We're actually supporting the sale process. The proceeds are not major, but certainly the dealers, for example, Saturn dealers, Hummer dealers that sign wind-down agreements would sign a new agreement with the purchaser of the business, and we're supporting this from the new company, and any proceeds would go to the new company.
Okay, we have a question on the back.
I am Kodaka from Nikkei News, and I think every car company focuses on customer, car, and culture. And how are you going to differentiate yourself to competitors, including Ford, Toyota, or Honda? Thank you.
Kodaka-san, oayou gozaimasu. My answer to that would be, we have to show you. I think I'm one of those people that believes that, you know, actions and results count more than anything else. I'm not sure, by the way, I agree with your first point that all car companies focus on cars, customers, and cultures. I actually think there are significant and subtle differences. What we want to do is be focused around that. Certainly having a culture, I got to make sure I get and look at you here, actually. Having a culture at General Motors, most people would say our culture to this point has been an impediment, and it has to change, and I would agree with that. It's about creating a culture that can be a winning culture, that's high performance, that's focused around that. It's obviously a lot leaner, a lot simpler, fewer layers, faster decision making. But then you just have to see the results. But I'm not, like I said, I'm not sure I agree with the contention that all car companies focus on those three. Some focus on more on one or the other. We want, and our aspiration is to be known when we're done with great results focused around those three items. Thank you.
We'll take one from Jeff Green, then we'll take two more in the room, and then we'll go back to the phone.
In our efforts to keep Bloomberg accurate in all instances, can you talk about your cost structure a little bit? It's sort of two questions at the same point. Is $10 million still the break-even EBITDA coming out of bankruptcy? And did you get to $48, $45 an hour labor costs to match the foreign competitors, which was sort of a key point of the whole process as we got started back in December?
$10 million is the break-even EBIT level, not EBITDA. And we do have capital spending, so EBITDA is not something I normally spend a lot of time on. We're fully competitive. I mean, we actually benchmarked, for example, our labor cost competitiveness versus Toyota, not only at their key plants but their Georgetown plant. We're very confident that we're fully competitive at our existing with our new labor agreements.
Tom Walsh from the Free Press.
Tom.
Hi, Fritz. On this culture and the management thing, in addition to unretiring Mr. Lutz here, do you anticipate bringing any more new blood into the organization at high levels? And secondly, how many people will be on that executive committee, and will it include positions, I don't know all the titles, currently filled by Gary Cowger, Ralph Segenda, or will those jobs be redefined or changed?
Well, the executive committee will have eight. It would include manufacturing and labor. It would not include systems as a regular basis. Systems actually has an important part of supporting lots of our businesses, but isn't necessarily involved in every day-to-day decision. So I really want this group to be focused on decisions that need to be made weekly to drive the business. And so if a system issue comes up, we'll deal with a systems issue, but Ralph doesn't have to be in a meeting every week. But manufacturing and labor for sure is a key part of the executive committee. In terms of openness to outside blood, absolutely. It's interesting. First of all, we're one of seven companies whose compensation practices need to be specifically approved by the special master. Reports to Tim Geithner. Our actual compensation for the top 25 has to be approved. It hasn't changed, by the way, today. But ultimately, how people are paid is a function of what Ken Feinberg approves. And in this world, actually, your ability to recruit people from the outside, if you don't know how you can pay them, is impossible. I would say going forward, yeah, we need to be open to change where it's necessary and where we need to bring talent in. I don't have anything I'm just going to sit here and announce today, but I think certainly we're open to it if we think it's required in order for us to perform.
Fritz, we're at that point where I'm going to ask you to go into the lightning round here and go quickly.
So Gene, I was going quick, actually.
So Gene Halliday from Advertising Age, then we'll go to the phone.
Hi, Fritz. How soon will we see ads for the new GM, and how important is it to focus on GM, the corporation, versus your four core brands at this point?
My philosophy is to focus around the four core brands here in the U.S. Obviously, you've got other brands, Buick in China or Opel in Europe, but let me just focus my attention here in the U.S. The four core brands needs to have the money. We have done some work behind the GM brand, particularly as we've gone through this difficult period of time, which I think was appropriate. But in general, our money needs to be put behind our four brands. In terms of how to do it, I think Bob has actually already told the team the reviews are scheduled for Monday, actually. So I would say stay tuned. But I would say we need to get moving on this now. But there's no question in my mind that our money should be focused on our vehicles and our brands, not necessarily on the corporation.
Okay, we're going to go to the phone. Mathis Rusch from the Financial Times.
Concerning Opel, how are the negotiations with Magna and with the Chinese bidders going on, and when will there be an outcome?
Negotiations continue with Magna, but not just with Magna, also with RHJI. We did receive a proposal from BAIC or Beijing Auto. Those negotiations continue. Think of this as work that I have a team of people over there this week and actually are just going to sit there and work in the month of July to try to bring this matter to closure. So don't have anything to announce today, but I can just tell you that we're working around the clock in Europe to try to bring a deal to closure.
Okay, we'll take one more on the phone. I think it's Alexander Freen from the London Times. Can't hear you yet.
Alexander, you're definitely not on.
Hello, can you hear me?
Now, but this doesn't sound like Alexander.
Alexandra.
Maybe. Okay.
Alexandra, it is. Could you explain how the auction is going to work in your experiment in California?
The we're working with eBay actually, and it's a derivative. It's, again, it's an experiment, but it's really about, you know, is there an interesting auction play? I would say today, if you want me to go into the second or third level, I would be unable to do that actually. But as we went through it, I said this is an interesting thing to do, and I think as a culture, General Motors needs to be prepared to experiment and then adjust. This is an example of doing just that. And then we'll have to see how it works. But we're pretty excited about this.
Okay, we'll take a question from Dave Guilford, Automotive News.
Hi, Dave.
Quick update on the Hummer deal. Is that going forward?
The purchaser for Hummer is actually going through the approval processes in China. And so we're cooperating with them, providing them the information they need. Our expectation, certainly. It's interesting, the purchaser of the business been very professional, very well advised, has done a huge amount of work. We have very good documentation, and we're supporting the sale process. So you know, ultimately the purchaser's approval process needs to go forward and be approved, and I don't control that. But you know, what's our expectation is that this deal can get done.
Fritz, we'll go Jeff Gilbert, WWJ.
Hi, Jeff.
Hi, Fritz. Quick clarification of the salary job cuts mentioned here. Is that any increase from what you announced previously, or is that essentially what was on plan? And the other part of the question is, you expect to get down to about 64,000 people in the U.S. by the end of the year. Is that the right size for the company? Does it look like, barring anything unforeseen, the cutting is pretty much behind us?
I would say no, it's not an increase. It's basically what we've announced today is, as I said, it's an enabler for us. 35% reduction, for example, in the salaried manpower over a course of a year you have to have fundamental change to do that. You can't just have people work 35% harder. And so this was an enabler. So there's no increases to what we've announced on either executives or on the salaried side. Second question. Oh, yeah. We actually think at that level we're right-sized in terms of capacity, both salaried manpower and hourly manpower. We're in the midst of an attrition plan today who I think closes July 23rd. So we'll see ultimately what happens there. But I think at that level we are right-sized here.
We're going to go to the far right over here.
Good morning. It's Kimberly Johnson with the Associated Press. You talked about needing to repay the government loans quickly, but when can we expect a break-even or even profitable quarter from GM? Do you have an estimate on that?
Well, I have a new board, actually, Kimberly, that we want to make sure that we take them through our financial projections and financial plans in detail. Our viability plan four basically had us at break-even EBIT next year, 2010, and 11 basically had us at a slightly above a break-even pre-tax and positive operating cash flow in 11. I don't have any reason to disbelieve those numbers, actually. But we need to completely bring our board up to speed on what our current thoughts are. As I told Ray, I said our first projection is going to be the 0 + 5 2/3. The year starts today, actually, in terms of the new General Motors. And so we want to take Ed Whitaker and the board through our projections. And my focus actually is the second half of 2009 and 2010, and then take a reasonably good look at 2011, too, and make sure we bring the board up to speed. And we'll have more to say on that. Our first board meeting is in early August, and so you'll see us have more to say about this probably in August and September.
We'll take one final question. Joe Sesney.
Fritz,
hi, Joe.
You've probably cut production for probably 10 straight quarters now. When would you expect that to turn around? Do you have a estimate for us?
We start bringing our plants up next week. Some of them start coming up next week. We had developed a plan to bring our inventory down to about 500,000 units by the end of this month. We expect to achieve that. We were at 570 at the end of June. And it's very important for us to actually correct our inventory levels, which we think we're on the way to doing. So I actually feel better as I come into the second half of the year that we'll be able to run the plants. Obviously, the industry itself is still remarkably weak, But the fact is we've been not only running at a weak industry, but we've been correcting inventory at the same time. I think the company is now, the new GM is born, if you will, so we have the ability and we do expect we would see more fleet orders coming into the system. And I do think that my outlook for production certainly is for stability. In terms of, you know, calculating year-over-year percentage increases, I'm not going to do that this morning, but I certainly feel better about our ability to run our plants on a stable basis as we go into the second half of the year, given that our inventories are going to be in a very good position.
We're going to stop there. Thanks very much.
Thanks very much.
Thanks for watching the Auto Channel. For more great automotive information and entertainment, visit theautochannel.com, the Internet's most complete and comprehensive automotive information resource.